More than 56 million elementary, middle, and high school students have returned back to school this fall in some form or another. Across the country, teachers are relying on different approaches, from in-person learning to remote online curriculums, or even a mix of both. It's safe to say that this year will be unlike any other.
There's a long list of challenges that teachers are facing this year. Uncertainty has been one of them. And in a lot of cases, they didn't know exactly how they were going to start until a few weeks, or in some cases, a few days before the beginning of the school year.
That's Justin Reich, an assistant professor at MIT and the director of the MIT Teaching Systems Lab. A central goal of the lab is to be a resource for teachers and administrators looking for better methods to learning. Reich is also the author of the new book, Failure to Disrupt: Why Technology Alone Can't Transform Education. Over the last several months, he's spoken with hundreds of teachers about the different sets of challenges they're facing this year.
In places where they're doing fully remote teaching, there's lots about fully remote, which is just hard to do. There's so much of teaching and the practice of teaching that depends upon the physical co-presence of people. In fact, one of the most common teaching maneuvers sometimes just goes by the name of presence. You know, if there's a student who's getting off track or getting a little bit rowdy or just isn't sort of in the right place for learning, a really common thing to do is for a teacher to just move and kind of stand next to that student and not say anything or make a big deal out of it. Just be next to the student who needs some more focus.
It's no secret that teaching is already a difficult job to begin with. In the U.S., there are more than 3.7 million teachers employed in public and private schools, according to the National Center for Education Statistics. These teachers don't enter into the field for money or prestige, but because they have a passion for learning and believe that a good teacher can inspire students for life.
A lot of the rewards of the job are being with kids and being there in those aha moments and getting excited with them as they're learning. And it's hard to experience those great feelings from a distance. And for lots of veteran teachers, it just feels like their first year of teaching all over again, where the things that they're doing are not as effective as they want them to be, where their plans aren't coming together the way they want, where students are frustrated and families are frustrated.
The frustration is very real and will likely continue as districts navigate the new daily challenges of operating during a pandemic. On the first day of school, several schools reported issues with online learning, like school websites crashing from too many people logging on, or malware and viruses infecting entire network systems. Reich adds that students from low-income households face more problems when it comes to learning online.
There are estimates that over 10 million students don't have the internet connection that they need, that there are millions more students who don't have the devices that they need to be successful. So the digital divide is a huge issue in this country. And I think one unfortunate set of rhetoric that's been going around during the pandemic is this claim that it's the school's responsibility to address that, that if families with children don't have technology, don't have computers, or don't have broadband access, that somehow schools are supposed to fix that in our society. But like, the superintendent of your local public school cannot run fiber optic cable down dirt roads into villages and things like that. They can't force broadband companies to provide equitable, non-redlined access within cities. It's not a responsibility that schools can take on. Schools barely have enough resources to do their primary function of schooling. And so if there aren't other parts of our society, the federal government, state government, municipalities that step in to providing these resources, it's not going to happen.
On top of the basic tools needed for remote learning, teachers have to find new ways to keep students engaged and motivated from home. That same connection and excitement about learning found in the classroom is hard to replicate over video, especially for students who aren't curious about the subject matter to begin with.
In places that are starting fully remote, there needs to be a real emphasis on building the relationships between teachers and students, between students and each other, between teachers and families, that are really the foundation of schooling.
Another aspect that Dr. Sanjay Sarma argues for is a shift in how school days are structured. Especially when learning online, it's difficult for a student to stay focused through an hour-long lesson and absorb all of the information. Sarma is the Vice President for Open Learning at MIT and co-author, along with Luke Yoquinto, of the book GRASP, The science transforming how we learn.
The thing about learning is that we have to absorb the information, we have to marshal it, we have to integrate it with other information, and we have limited short-term memory. So when a student's learning something new, to expect that they can absorb information for 45 minutes, all new stuff generally, is just impractical. You know, none of us remember, you know, the third thing we did this morning. No one remembers. So the way that we remember information is when it shows up a second time, a third time, especially spaced out, because then the brain goes, oh my God, this is important. I need to register this.
Virtual learning exacerbates these issues because being at home compared to a classroom is naturally more isolating. Students aren't interacting with their peers and teachers, and this can lead to a one-sided learning experience. Sarma says that we need to place some responsibility back in the students' hands and better communicate why the subject matter is applicable to real life.
It shouldn't be all about passing an exam and declaring victory. It's more about what will the student be able to do with this learning 3 years from now. Students who are really interested in a topic will really spend a lot more time absorbing it. So one of my suggestions is that we spend a lot more time, especially during the era of COVID, not during the classroom trying to make sure that the young person sits there and, you know, participates in the Zoom, but as prep to make sure they're curious about the material. That gives a lot better returns than pressure or turning into a chore. And I wish we did more of that, maybe focused on why is this important? Why is this exciting? Why is it different? What can you do with it? You know, context and curiosity. If you're learning, for example, magnetism, show them how electric cars are going to use permanent motor magnets and what a permanent motor magnet is. And, you know, if a student's interested in music, do you want to know how a speaker works? You know, how you get good sound out of it? Well, that's magnetism, right? Things like that.
Sarma says that moving forward, there are many things that we can learn from this pandemic, like what can be taught effectively online compared to what's better left for in-person classrooms.
To me, good in-person learning will always trump even good online learning. What we have right now is bad online learning, right? Because everyone's scrambling, right? I mean, it's understandable. It's, again, we're all trying to give the same lectures we used to give in Zoom. Even a very engaging teacher on Zoom is going to be hobbled by Zoom. But in good in-person learning is amazing because this magic is very hard to recreate. Whether it's doing an experiment in a chemistry lab or playing the piano and having someone tell you to do a different thing with art or, you know, how you hold your pencil. So to me, in-person is fantastic. But in fact, the point I'm making is because in-person is so fantastic, let's not squander that time with stuff you could do better online, right? Let's make time to do the things online can do and focus on that bit in person.
Educational online resources like Khan Academy and Coursera are fantastic platforms that offer courses on countless topics. But Reich says that these, along with other similar programs, are supplemental rather than a complete fix-all solution to online education.
For the last 2 decades, we've had education technology evangelists telling people that we were on the cusp of an educational revolution and technology was going to radically transform the way we provide schooling and the way people learn. And those claims have just been overwrought. And in fact, you know, that bubble has burst in a profound way during the pandemic, where instead of having a moment for education technology to shine as a savior, I think most families have found remote schooling incredibly frustrating. And, you know, I think one of the main things I try to argue in Failure to Disrupt is that the core mistake that most folks make in talking about and thinking about education technology is that for the most part, we haven't built things that transform whole systems or transform whole curricula or transform whole approaches to teaching and learning. Rather, what we have are tools that are more particular. You know, they're pretty good for certain subjects or certain parts of subjects for certain students in certain contexts. But that's kind of the challenge of figuring out how to use technology effectively in schools during this moment.
If you're a parent, teacher, or work in any facet of education, it's important to cut yourself some slack this fall. It's a new landscape with many challenges, and everyone's doing their best to figure it out day by day. To learn more about this topic and our guests, Justin Reich and Dr. Sanjay Sarma, visit viewpointsradio.org. You can also find both of their books, Failure to Disrupt, Why Technology Alone Can't Transform Education, and GRASP, The Science Transforming How We Learn, available online now. This segment was written and produced by Amira Zaveri. I'm Gary Price. Coming up on Viewpoints.
It's predicated on creating a customer experience that is one of consistency and continuous offering of product.
Exploring the dark side of our food supply system. Then,
finding a professional to work with their student is extremely challenging right now.
Navigating the school system this year. I'm Marty Peterson.
And I'm Gary Price. These stories in depth on your public affairs magazine, Viewpoints.